this term. When we finish Devil's Rejects, I think to a man, to a woman, everyone, the crew, all the actors, we all said we'd like to take a month off and come back this time and start it over again. We really enjoyed it. He was very, very creative. He made it a very relaxed set.
Yeah.
Scott Weidinger and I came out. Scott came out to L.A. just before I did, and you know, I came out, and we were still struggling actors. As a matter of fact, I'm gonna take it back a little further, and it's gonna take just a second. I was working with at a theater company that was across from Lincoln Center. I don't know if you know Lincoln Center in New York, and it was called the Hazel Bryant Acting Ensemble. And there were several people there who are now established themselves as major players in our industry. And one was named Jackie Harry, and I don't know if you know who she is. She's in a series called 227, and she did soap operas, and she was quite famous, and you know who she is, of course. Yeah. So she's quite popular in the United States. But this was a time when we were all, you know, we were struggling actors, and I had just finished Dawn of the Dead. And we were rehearsing on 42nd Street, 9th and 10th Avenues, and this was the old bus station that used to be the Newman Day Record. And it was deserted and empty, and it had cables on the floor and puddles. And we were rehearsing in this place, but we had a theater up near Lincoln Center, but it's where we rehearsed this play. And Jackie and I were coming back from rehearsal, and we were going uptown, and we passed the Winter Garden Theater. And there, that's 50th Street and 7th Avenue, I believe, and off Broadway. And that was, there was Dawn of the Dead everywhere. My name all over the place, my picture everywhere. And she looked at me and she said, "Ken, you're a star." And I said, "Jackie, we're walking because we can't afford bus fare to get home." I said, "What the hell does that mean?" And that was the truth. That's what we're doing. And there's one more. So I get out to LA, just to move it forward a little bit. I get out to LA, Scott's already out there. And Scott's working for a limousine company. And it's a small company, so they got four cars or something like that. I said, "Scott, I just got here. I'm trying to find a job, you know, because then, you know, getting with my agent, you know, we're doing that kind of thing." And he said, "Okay," so he got me on with his limousine company, and so I started working with him and, you know, the company. I drove a limousine for about 6 months. That's all I could take, because I wanted to kill everybody I picked up in the night. They were horrible people, horrible, you know. And so I had to pick up someone at the airport. So I go to LAX, Los Angeles Airport. I walk in, and I see this guy come in, and he says, "Oh, Ken Foree! Oh my God, I love your acting. I love what you do. You're the greatest." I mean, it's the greatest thing since warm milk for this guy, you know. Just all of it. You know, people passing by, and I'm in this little black, suit, and so I had my tie. He said, "What are you doing here? I saw you in Dawn of the Dead at the Westchester Drive-In Theater, man. My girl and I love you." And he said, once we dropped off a few other people, and then, you know, we were driving him and his girlfriend and Daniel Melnick and his date home. And he said, "How's it feel to put in a performance like that and try, and now you're driving a limousine?" I said, pretty fucking shitty, if you want to know the truth. So that's, you know, it spread everywhere. I mean, people, I had no idea, when I left New York, it was in Indiana, I started doing television interviews on all the major networks in Indianapolis, Indiana, PBS in Indianapolis, Indiana. I took countless relatives to the theater every night that I was there, because they all had to see it with their cousin. And it was, you know, it just spread everywhere. So, and I think I told them yesterday about the SAG thing, because I got in trouble because I was the only SAG member of the cast, and I didn't figure it would play this country. And it spread so, you know, it played everywhere, so everyone knew about it, and eventually I was called on the carpet by SAG for being in the movie. So that's when I knew that I had something. You know, but by the time I got to Indiana, I said, this has got to be, you know. So anyway, that's whatever that means.
Thank you.
Okay. Did I overread this question? I think. Don't get me started, all right?
Can I offer some footnotes?
I don't own this show.
Footnote number one is SAG is the Screen Actors Guild, SAG. It's the
you know that, don't you?
It's the union of movie performers. And he was working non-union, and the union takes it very seriously. Footnote number two is, I have often been asked, is it pronounced Foray or Foray?
Foray.
And you pronounce Foray?
Foray.
Accent on the second syllable?
Yes.
Cool.
Yes. French Huguenot. Yes.
Accent number three is, to encapsulate, what is it like to work with George? It's like working with a friendly and well-organized bear.
Oh, the bear. He's like a grandpa, yes.
David Early, who played Mr. Berman, my partner in that scene that died a couple of years ago. I miss him. Our secret was we were colleagues, longtime colleagues. We had worked on stage together many times. And in fact, that's how we were cast. George came to see us in a play, The Trial of the Catonsville Nine, about some war protesters, priests, likely the priests, who were put in jail because they protested the Vietnam War. And George came and saw us in that play and said, yeah, those guys will work in that scene. So he cast us right then and there. And the chemistry between us was rich because we had a history and also because we rehearsed a lot. In movies, you often don't get to rehearse much, but on stage, you rehearse for weeks before you perform the play for an audience. And we were used to that custom. So we rehearsed our scene in my little apartment above a pizza shop many times before we went to the set to film it.
Yeah, Scott and I auditioned for Dawn with Scott, David, Galen. The first audition was with them. Then they called me back 3 or 4 days later and had me audition with three other people. And there was a chemistry that they were looking for. There was another guy in the second audition who would have played Scott's character. And we kept bumping heads because I was going to lead and he was going to lead. And it wasn't working. I didn't mind it so much. I noticed it a little bit, but it's okay. We're auditioning. You don't let him do it. You know, we're both are actors. But I knew that it wasn't as quite as smooth as what happened with Scott and I, Galen and David. He was an athlete, I was an athlete. We were both pretty cocky, you know, so that kind of played into it. And we played off each other fairly well, you know, so that's basically what it was. We continued to kind of partner up and try to play with trash prints, and mine certainly was a little different than his, but it worked. I'm not sure if it was any kind of magical thing that happened. I just think that if we were just the right people, the right time, the right personalities that mixed and it worked well for us.
Yeah. Unfortunately, that's all the time we have for today, but people can find you at your table and talk some more, and tomorrow you will be back on stage.
Tomorrow.
Yeah.
Ooh.
All right, so give it up for Camp Parade and David Crawford.